go.
Okay, so the topic here is hardening web application security. And a few words about myself. I'm Jouni Huttunen, and I work as a software architect and also full stack developer at Solita company. I finished my master's degree 2010 on software engineering in Finland. And at that point I was already working at Solita. I've been there working over 10 years now. And now I moved in to Tallinn 10 weeks ago. So I'll be working here as an expatriate worker for 6 months more. And why am I interested about cybersecurity? Of course, one is the professional interest, because we want to make secure software that doesn't leak any data or you can't hack it. And also, the cybersecurity, nowadays I think it has very interesting stories, because there are multiple major players from all big nations, also cyber criminals, hackers, and white hat hackers. So it's kind of a wild, wild west with really exciting stories. And because the security has been really badly done, we have these stories a lot to read. So it's very interesting. And also I see it as a challenging game where you can play pretty much on both sides, the blue team or on the red team. Because when we are developing an application, of course we want to make it secure. But the best way to do it, to make it secure, is that you kind of try to think how can you attack against it. So you get to play mind games, play attacks on your own applications. And of course you can play attacks on other applications, but just don't do them, don't execute them. They might not like it. But yeah, I find that this is really interesting area. And then a few words about my company, about Solita. We provide customers digital solutions, consultation. Pretty much if customer has a problem that we can help them, we try to help them, and we offer digital services, consultation, software development, of course, data analytics, and service design. Quite a lot more, but these are maybe the main offerings. We work for private and public sector customers, and we have over 700 employees, 20 years in business, and over 76 million turnover. And we have offices in 4 countries and in quite a lot of cities. And we are at the Munich office just started months ago, and we are expanding and growing. So if you are looking for interesting challenges, please go and check our open positions. So that's my sponsored section. Now to that. Now about the topic itself. I see that security is part of the software development, and just like writing the code, the developer is responsible firsthand. I don't see that security can be, or that it should be, delegated to some specialist who then does the security audit and either approves it or declines it, and then it goes back to the developer. I see that the developer, they must themselves know how to build secure applications, test them, and after that, yeah, we might have some experts, just like we have quality assurance testers who do the final testing, but it still doesn't mean that the developer can do a sloppy job. No, the developer must know how the application is secure and how it's bug-free. And I think that quite often the security is underrated concern. This is something that we can see just watching news, that how many personal details have leaked recently, and how many insecure applications are there? I mean, you don't have to Google quite long to find plenty of these. And I think that one reason why it's so underrated is that before there was pretty much no liability and the sanctions were rarely used. Pretty much every big company has pretty much messed up in some way. And if they are really big players, then they get some fines, some sanctions. But for Facebook, what was this? How big sanction did they get?
Zook got the trials.
That was good. But I mean, like the money, you think like Facebook has multi-billion revenue, the liabilities are still quite low. So, and before, like a few years ago, it was maybe a slap on the hand, nothing serious. Now that the GDPR is in place, I hope that they will use it to give out heavy sanctions if companies still continue to mess up with security and are not taking it well seriously. And the point of this presentation is to give a few simple steps how to improve application security. And the story states that this is how you, well, my story for this topic states that this is how everybody can pass a security audit with flying colors. So I'll skip to them. This is maybe the most useful, the most pragmatic slide. This contains two very useful test sites that you can use to test your application or pretty much any website. The first one, securityheaders.com, it will check what security headers your site is using. And it will also tell you if it's lacking something, it will tell you why this is a good header in a secure sense. So it's also very educative. The second one, it's for testing the HTTPS certificate and cipher security. It's also quite good, and if you get A+ from both sites, then you are doing quite well in general, I would say. And because nobody wants to type these links, I posted them on Twitter using DEVCLUB66 hashtag. So it should be quite easy to find. But now, back to the story. So the story was that we were developing an application for one Finnish customer. And this customer, they have a quite important role, so they want that every their application goes through a quite strict security audit. I can't name the customer, but they were expecting a nation-state attacker, so not just some script kiddies. The site itself, it was a public CMS site that's written in C# over .NET, so it wasn't any WordPress site, luckily. And we have had quite a good security practices for a long time, and they were quite good. But during this project, we tuned them up and have been continuously improving them. And the basic principles, well, the basic principles for a good security strategy is to minimize the attack surface. The attack surface, it presents all the attack vectors you can use to attack the site and breach in. You can think of it like a house. If house has many windows and many doors, it's pretty easy to find some place that's not so secure and go in. Whereas if you have only one door, it's very easy to secure it and watch who's going in and out. What we want to do is we want to minimize all the attack vectors, all the ways to get in. Because once we minimize all the unnecessary ways to get in or use the application, we have a lot less to test, and we can be more we can use more time to test the existing attack vectors, the places you can attack against. So when we cut out and minimize the attack surface, we save our time and we make the attacker's life a lot more harder. And there are a lot of automatic attack tools that can scan for common issues, and pretty much like maybe one of the most horrible things you can do is that if you have a virtual machine operating Windows, you put it on the internet and you don't have any firewalls. I bet that if it's not updated, it will quite soon be infected. So keeping all the attack surfaces as minimized as possible, that's one basic measure. The other is principle of least privilege. Basically, it is that you don't want to give anything more privileges and more access than it necessarily requires. And let's say that, for example, if we are running an application and the application accesses the database, if the database user, if it has admin rights to the database, it can read and it can do a lot more than it's necessary to do. And if you might have multiple different roles. Some roles require only read access for some tables. Now if your application gets infected or you have a SQL injection, it's restricted what you can do in the database. So you want to minimize the application privileges. Also, for servers, you want to minimize where the server is allowed to access, what the server can actually do, because it might be that your application is not the main target. If your application just happens to be in the customer's intranet environment or in a data center where there are pretty open firewall rules, and your application just happens to be the weakest links, it might be used to just break in into some other target. So to minimize the fallout if your application gets compromised, you don't want to have any unnecessary privileges. Just keep them tight and keep them small as minimum as possible. A typical web application architecture is pretty much that we have a user. User communicates over the internet with the application server, and in here you want to use firewalls to block all the unnecessary access. And then the application server uses databases and maybe other Elasticsearch and maybe other microservice APIs, other resources. This is the overall picture, and in here we have a lot of places where the attacker can attack. So to speak, we have a lot of attack surface here. Let's see how we can minimize it. If we start with infrastructure, the server side, actually this is better. First of all, we can limit the ports open to the public internet, because it's a web application. We only want to allow HTTP and HTTPS for the public internet, so that there won't be any remote desktop protocols open, no SSH, no nothing, no NetBIOS. So that if they try to port scan the application and the whole environment, they only get HTTP ports. And within the server environment, we don't want the web server to have any unnecessary access. It only needs to access, well, in this case, database, Elasticsearch, and a certain API, and we know the ports, so we can also firewall the connections. And database server, or not anyone, any of these servers can access each other, or they can't access the outside world. So every connection is beforehand firewalled. They can only connect to resources they have access. That's quite simple, but requires some firewall configurations. But we need to somehow, of course, maintain the, let's say that these are virtual machines, we need to somehow maintain them. And we can use, well, if they are running Windows, we can use remote desktop procedure protocol, or if they are Linux, then SSH. But we don't want to expose these ports to the for the public internet. What we should do is to use virtual private networks, or at least IP restrictions. And if we are using VPNs, then using multi-factor authentication helps a lot. Because if you're using multi-factor authentication, then the attacker, they need your credentials and they need your smartphone too.
Question, you mean using multi-factor authentication only for people, not for machines?
Because people, yes. For, let's say like you're a developer and you need to access the machines. So what I would do is that I would have a configuration that I must first activate virtual private network, and this virtual private network, it requires my credentials and it sends me multi-factor authentication message, usually with phone. So even if attacker would get my VPN credentials, they can't use the VPN unless they have my smartphone. So it's a lot more work for them. Basically, this is making it just steps to make it harder for the attacker. And also, if you create a virtual machine in AWS or in Azure, and you don't restrict the SSH or RDP to certain VPNs or IPs, they will be constantly bombed by bots. And actually, one of our virtual machines, it was created just to test some feature. So it was a temporary virtual machine in Azure. It was hacked because the password, it was too easy, and I guess some dictionary attack found it. But I mean, it wasn't supposed to be even there for a long time, just a test machine, and it was gone. So it's always good to secure logins to the servers. And previously, I talked about virtual machines, but of course you want to be able to use cloud resources too, because cloud is very nice. And usually cloud resources are quite safe, because they only expose the ports and the interfaces you really need.
If you use them properly.
Yes, properly.
Because you can put it like whereas on the internet as well.
Yes, you can. And yeah, this is something like restricting access, that is something that we can do. Like for example, if we have some storage, blob storage in Azure, by default you can access it anywhere around the world. But there are mechanisms how you can limit that you can only access it from the same cloud environment. And with certain resources, you can use firewalls to block certain IPs, well, to allow only certain IPs. And this is something that if you are using the cloud resources, it's better to know all the options and be familiar, because with Amazon S3 buckets, they made quite silly mistake not restricting the access. And it has been for few years at least now that there have been quite periodically open S3 buckets that anybody can read, and they have had some quite confidential data. And the problem is that it has just been a silly configuration option that they didn't restrict the access, and they didn't found that it was public to the whole world. But this cutting all unnecessary interfaces and attack vectors, it doesn't only apply to infrastructure, it applies to the application too. If you have administrative or editing capabilities in your application that are allowed only for your employees or for really limited audience, you can also limit the access with virtual private networks or even with strict IP rules. For example, you can have a public server and a private server that contains all the admin features. This way, if the attacker tries to attack against the public server, they won't find anything useful there. It's only there to serve data. They can't do anything with it. And if they want to attack the private sector and the private server, they need to access the virtual private network or the environment that is allowed to access it. So this is a really effective way to cut a lot of attack vectors. And it also mitigates stolen credentials and session hijacking, because let's say that you get admin credentials for the application user interface. You won't do anything with them because you can't access the login screen, or even if you can hijack the session, you can't do anything with it. And also, quite often we use different kind of tools, libraries, and products. And these products, they have quite a lot of different features by default. If you don't need some feature, just disable it, because it might be, well, it's unnecessary, of course, if it's not used, but it might contain some bugs, it might contain vulnerabilities that can be exploited. So everything you don't need, just cut it out and use the features you really need. Like for example, WordPress, it has XML RPC support. And this support is by default enabled for some reasons. And it makes brute forcing really easy, because it allows you to try hundreds of credentials at one time. So you don't have to just try one credential at a time. You can send list of hundreds of credentials, and this helps a lot to attack. Well, not only brute forcing, but for dictionary attacks too. And also the same feature, it allows a pingback feature, and you can use this for denial of service attacks. And like the common suggestion is to disable this feature. It's so silly that it's enabled by default. But I think this is maybe the most brutal example, because WordPress is quite used and there is no practical reason that this is enabled. Also, during the development, we might use some debugging interfaces or tools. And of course, you want to also move them before moving to production, because these tools, they might be quite powerful. You might accidentally leave a backdoor to your system. And the debugging, it might contain critical information about the system. Like one site I was auditing, I discovered that it was using a third-party library, and this library, by default, it has a debug interface. And this debug interface, it shows all the libraries the application uses, some configuration and the license keys. And because you can see all the libraries it uses, you can see the exact versions. You can find vulnerabilities against certain libraries. You can easily scan the list. And also because some of the custom libraries were named by the company, you could easily see that, oh, this is the provider. And you have the license key. And you know, from the software library versions, you can pretty much guess that, okay, this is the time frame that when this program application was built. Then you can go to LinkedIn and guess that who has been working on it. Now you have pretty much information about who has worked on it. You have the license keys, a pretty much of knowledge that only the developers should know. You can use this for social engineering. So no, not good. The less we give information about the application, the better. This also applies to exception screens. If we have an exception while we are developing, it's of course critical to know all the details. But in public environment, we don't want to show any stack traces or anything about that some error has happened. But yeah, summarizing this part, we want to cut away, summarizing like this is how we can make the application safe, just by improving infrastructure and application interfaces. We want to cut away so much attack vectors, attack surface, much as possible, because it will make our job much more easier. We can do it by exposing only what is necessary. Only thinking what server ports do we actually need, and what application features and endpoints are necessary. And when we have certain needs for developers, admins, other privileged users, it's good to secure them with virtual private networks and use MFA if possible. Then about securing the connection, and by connection I mean how the user access the website. A simple, well, I would say like the basic thing, really the basic thing is that use HTTPS always. Unencrypted plain HTTP is not acceptable, because the traffic can be monitored, altered, and routed to malicious servers. Without HTTPS and TLS certificate, you can't verify that you are now communicating with the right server, right host. And there is no valid reason not to use HTTPS anymore. It doesn't affect performance, not anymore. And even mobile devices can handle it very well. Yes?
One justified practice that we've been discussed the other day with colleagues is they had a case where they had a service-oriented architecture with their product, and then they had services running in the cloud, in virtual private cloud.
Yes.
And then they had and then they had protobuf interfaces between services, and then in order to speed it up, they enabled HTTP because all the traffic was like between their own services and within virtual private network, inaccessible to outside world. But then everything that was internet facing was obviously of course HTTP.
Yeah, and quite often, when we have a secure network, quite often the HTTPS is actually terminated on the load balancer. So usually if you trust the network enough, usually behind the firewall it goes unencrypted, because if you have a load balancing using end-to-end encryption makes it a bit hard.
Yeah.
Yeah. But usually like having the public internet, having the HTTPS over the public internet, that's the critical part. Actually, some years ago, it was when Google, when these NSA leaks came out, and what they used was that before Google, they didn't encrypt traffic between their data center transfers, and NSA could sniff that traffic. When it came out, Google quickly updated their security measures, so that now in Google I don't know about within the data centers, but at least in Google's own fiber between the data centers, now it's fully encrypted. So it's always that you have to know that, can you trust this environment or not? But yeah, we want to use HTTPS over the public internet. And how can we do it? Well, we want to have both HTTP and HTTPS endpoints available for convenience, because when the user enters the address, the browser might connect first to HTTP endpoint, and we want to be able to redirect the user over secure HTTPS. So for example, yeah, you go to Solidafi and it sends a redirect over HTTPS. But what about if the user has logged in over a secure connection, they now have a session cookie, and then they manually enter the unsecure HTTP site. Well, the session cookie, it will be sent unencrypted, because this is a capture of a site that does the HTTPS redirect. And I have logged on to the site, but it's returning moved redirection as it should. But my request is sending the cookies unencrypted. So if somebody was listening, they could steal my session cookie. That's not good. A very simple way to mitigate this is to use secure cookies. It's a cookie attribute. Attribute that it's just, well, secure attribute set. If you have it set, the browser won't send these cookies over unencrypted connection ever. So even if the user would want to go to the unencrypted page, the browser would exclude these cookies from the request. And I think this is good to set the set for every cookie. Because if your site is going to use HTTPS always, there is no valid reason not to use this. You don't want to expose anything over unsecure connection. A more, well, complement, a more strict way is to use HTTP strict transport security. What it does is that it enforces the browser to use only HTTPS connection. If there are some links that refer unencrypted HTTP site, the browser will automatically upgrade these links over HTTPS. And if the user, if it tries to enter the unencrypted site, it won't do the request. And if there is some problem with the certificate, you can't access it. So this is a really good and easy way to enforce HTTPS, because you can issue it quite easily by just sending a HTTP header that states well, the header name and then the lifetime. But you have to send this over a secure connection, because otherwise it would, if you would be able to send it over HTTP connection and it wouldn't have a working HTTPS endpoint, it would just be a complete.
Question. Can it damage your SEO stuff in a way, for example, like imagine you used to run your like landing page or your blog on HTTP, and then Google over time raised ranks on certain like resources on your site, and then you upgraded to HTTPS and set this STS cookie, and then like when a customer looks for the product you sell or looks for your like valuable information on the internet, they get results from this like HTTP links, then they go there and then they cannot be redirected because of.
Well, if your site is working this way that the link is old, the user comes to the link, the site automatically upgrades the link over HTTPS, and
there is the same place.
Yep, okay. And during the first request, well, first happens the HTTP request, then the user is redirected over HTTPS. After that, the HSTS header is sent, and the browser remembers that if they again see the link or link to this server, the browser automatically upgrades the connection over HTTPS. But of course, if at some point you decide you break your TLS certificate, then it won't work. But no, it won't break existing links, because the browser, if they know that this site should always be accessed secure way, it automatically will upgrade every request and every link. So no, you don't have to worry about broken links.
Okay, thank you.
And Google will actually rank your site better if you are using encryption, HTTPS. So I would say that this is really easy to issue, and it's really, really good. You can also have a preload list, because there's a problem that when the user is making the first request, and they must first query the IP address from DNS server. But what about if you can hijack this request and give them a wrong IP? Then the first unsecure HTTP request is sent to the malicious host. And if they don't send the HSTS request and they are not using certificates, you can't know in that case that is this valid site or not. So if you want to have your site really secure, there's a list of sites that are built into the major browsers. I mean, they are hard-coded to Chrome, Explorer, Firefox. And if you enter one of these sites, the browser knows that it won't ever allow you to access it unencrypted. The downside is that because it's a hard-coded list, it can't contain every website. So I think they have quite high checks that which sites should go there. But if you are making some banking website, yeah, maybe that might be good. Also, what it requires is that for the domain, all subdomains must use HTTPS. And that might be a huge problem, because if you have a corporate domain, there might be some legacy sites which are not still using HTTPS. And if you enforce this, you make them unaccessible with major browsers. So use this with care, but it's good to know that there is also option to have a hard-coded HTTPS.
Excuse me?
Yes?
Is there a way to test this in any way yourself? Let's say that I would want to try out what happens if I would apply this to my domain. What would be the way? I could compile my own browser and I could add this my own domain, the list.
Yes.
Testing
the list, I think that because Chrome is based on Chromium open source project, I guess that you could compile your own version where you could add your own addresses and test how the browser actually works. And then you can capture the traffic with Wireshark and see that it doesn't send anything inappropriate. But pretty much, yeah, this how to test this list, I don't know, because it might be that they are not even accepting your request to add your site. But the HSTS header, this is something that you can test, because you only need to add the header, and then you can try to access unsecure resources. To summarize how to secure the connection part, it's pretty much concentrated on using HTTPS. And you can enforce HTTPS with the HSTS header, something that is very easy to do. And just one step more to mitigate session hijacking, you can use secure cookies, which is also very easy to set up. Then the last part, which is protecting the client side. Client side is very vulnerable to cross-site scripting. The name itself is quite misleading, because in general it means that the attacker has some way of injecting JavaScript onto your website. And if they can do that, they can do pretty much anything. It's a game over. They can change the whole page layout. They can change the URL query string. And common types for this attack are reflected and stored. Well, the reflected attack, it's the more common. It's when you found that, for example, you have maybe some site that allows you to enter queries. And if it's really badly done, you can enter HTML tags into the query and it will be displayed on the page. And it's not encoded, so you can pretty much inject your own JavaScript into the page. But in order to use this attack, you have to somehow make the target to click this exact link. Well, that might be quite easy, because of course you can just mask them. You can just make it some nice link and the user clicks it. But what about, won't they be able to see that it has a huge, huge query string? Not really, because once you can execute this attack, you can use HTML history API and clear the whole query string. It will look just as good as it should, except that now your browser has been hijacked. The other one is that, for example, when you can inject the save the script on the server side. For example, if you have a blog and there's a commenting section, if it's not properly handled, then you can inject JavaScript into the comments, and they will be executed for every visitor. This is kind of more bad, because now you don't have to send any links. Everybody who visits the page will be infected.
But this would then require the rendering engine or the JavaScript runtime to call eval on every to call JavaScript eval on the comment content, right? This is not a real world thing.
Not really, because if the comments are made really simple way that you write a comment and it allows you to inject HTML tags. You can just write your own.
You just write a script and
when the page is rendered, if it will be rendered as one exactly the same as a user entered it, you can enter any HTML there, and instead of a comment text, it will render the HTML there, and you can. It doesn't have to be executed with eval, because you can just write it as a script there. The script can be anywhere. It can be inside the body area too.
But the
most simple way to handle these kind of things is to HTML code all data. Because HTML encoding, what it does is that when we have special characters, like in here, the first example, the script alert, it encodes them so that it won't be executed as HTML. So in here, if the user would try to enter script tags, it would be just encoded literals, and the browser would render it as readable text. Also, this works if you are attacking against, let's say the first example here, input value. If you want to be able to show that this input value was something that the user entered, and if we give the user, they can enter anything, they can continue it by adding, breaking the quote, and then adding event handler attribute, like on mouse over, and then do something. But also the HTML encoding, it also prevents this, because it encodes the quotation marks. This handles pretty much the basic use cases, but there are some caveats, like you should never insert user input inside script tags, because it's completely impossible to sanitize correctly, or in attribute event handlers, or in CSS, or in URL. There are certain places that should be out completely. But what about if the site is, what about if it gets CSS infected? Well, one thing you can do if you can write custom JavaScript, one thing you can do is you can read the session cookie value and then pass it to some another party, and they can then hijack your session. For this, there's easy mitigation. You can use HTTP only attribute for cookies. It's a bit similar like secure attribute. What it does is it prevents JavaScript from accessing the cookie at all. It can't read it, it can't modify it. So if there are some cookies that shouldn't be read or modified on client side, this is it. Use this. And this, okay, this is a more strict mechanism, content security policy. It's also a header value added to requests. What it does is it allows you to define where the browser can download scripts on this site. And not only scripts, but images, media, styles, any other resource. Also, you can disable inline JavaScript, so you can't anymore inject inline script tags or execute eval. And you can define that if these rules are broken, it will report in JSON format to a given URL. So this way you know that if somebody is trying to inject something or do something that's not allowed, you actually get a warning. That's nice, but it's a bit. It may cause problems if you have a lot of third-party libraries. For example, YouTube. YouTube downloads resources from other domains, so you have to update all the domains that these dependencies use. For example, if you are using some analytic library, it might they might update their own dependencies at any time. And then your site is broken because your
that violates its
own. Yeah. So this is like, if you have a lot of third-party libraries, you might think, is it worth it? But I highly support this. And you can set the rules, like even disabling JavaScript eval and inline JavaScript. That helps a lot.
So this maybe as a general rule of thumb, this might be maybe not necessary for very customer-facing parts like promotional landing pages and that kind of stuff, and highly valuable on more of a back office stuff or where customer creates a session.
Yes, login, for example, login screen. You don't want to have analytic libraries on your login screen.
Or like after they log in on their dashboard.
Yeah. So this is use it with care, but this is highly valuable, and this is really strict measure to prevent attacks. Yes. Okay. Let's go to over this. So to summarize the client side, XSS attacks are the most common ones, and the easy way is to HTML encode all data. Use the session HTTP only attributes and content security policy. If it's appropriate, it's very good to use. A few. Actually, these other ones, they are quite simple. 5 minutes, so.
we still have 10 minutes, so maybe.
Okay, maybe, yes, good. Yeah, I have way too much. I have way too much. Yeah. But
let's. These are really cool things. SQL injections,
yeah. I think, like, this is. Yeah. And SQL injections, they are quite common, but back in the years, they were a lot more common because so much PHP crap. But there are very easy ways to prevent SQL injections. It's to use parameterized statements or prepared statements. This is the mechanism that where you first have the SQL query, then you insert placeholders, and then you create statement and you inject or set the you bind the variables to the placeholders. When using this mechanism, the database and the connection, they won't mess up data and the query structure. You can't do injections if you're using this mechanism. And it's not slower, it doesn't have any major downsides to my knowledge. Stored procedures, they are pretty much the same thing that you have to, except they are saved to the server side, database side. But these are the easiest steps to avoid SQL injections. And if you at some point see string concatenation with SQL queries, walk away. It's very, very, very unsafe. And well, when we are persisting user passwords, this is quite a common case that the databases, they leak all the time. And it might be just that your colleague or database admin is a bit too curious, and they might be Googling that, what's my friend's password? So you don't want the passwords to be in plain text. And we know, pretty much everybody knows that you have to use hash and salt. Why? Okay, hashing makes the input, in this case the password, it obfuscates it in that way that always the same input produces the same output, and you can't resolve the input from the hash. But if you are only using the hash, you can have gigabytes, maybe terabytes even, pre-calculated hashes. And now you can just look up the hash and the matching password. Okay, that's why you want to have salt. When you have hash and password, then you can't use pre-calculated dictionaries. You have to calculate your own dictionaries if you want to use them. And this is a This is why you want to use unique salt per password. Because if any user, if all credentials, they have own unique salt, then you have to brute force each row. Whereas if the salt would be common for all the database users, you could just brute force your own dictionary and then see that, okay, these users, they match. But with each individual hash, you can still, of course, brute force it, but you can't use these same results to resolve the other passwords. I'm thinking. Maybe. I think like at this point I might show them. Let's see them. Yeah.
If there's. I'd like to open up these things. Okay, good.
Yeah, I just so that I'm not messing up with the recording. Yeah, okay, this is good. Mm-hmm. Then let's just enter. Let's enter this DEVCLUB.EE.
Here.
Enter address DEVCLUB. Let's use yours. DEVCLUB.
Oh, let's not.
I have checked the results. This is something fun. Scan. Oh, yeah. This is a. There you can see that it warns about missing headers. And it gives the site a rating. Well, this is good because there's something to improve. And it states all the headers that you have. And also.
What's the lowest rating?
This is the worst. So with two fingers, you can scroll.
Yeah, okay. And this is good because. This is very educative, because here it tells you that what headers are you missing, and why is it a security risk if you are missing them, and it has links to more details. This is a very good site to use to test your own sites and well the sites you are using. And the other one, it's if you check the Twitter tag DEVCLUB66. There's the other one, but it's more slow to load, so you can check it on your own time. Okay.
Well, so, yeah. Thank you so much, Jouni.
Thank you. Thank you.
From DEVCLUB, we have a little present for you. These are branded DEVCLUB socks.
Awesome. Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.